All right, let's stand and worship together this morning.
All right, thank you so much. You can be seated. Welcome to Welling Church. We're so excited to have you this morning. We were scheduled to have spring, and then it just blew away here for a second. So I hope you enjoyed it. Winter will start tomorrow. That was it for us. But very glad you're here. We've got a lot of special guests with us, helping us with the music and helping with different areas around. If you're here on a regular basis, you'll probably notice them. But we've got 26 who came from North Carolina on their Easter break to help our church with some evangelism and outreach, and even this morning with doing some bits and bobs in the service. So very, very thankful for them. If you're a first-time guest with us, we are so honored that you would be here this morning. Of all of the amazing churches you could have gone to, we're humbled you would be here with us today. We hope it's a blessing and an encouragement to you being here with us. If you are new, you may not know where everything is at, and so would love to share a little bit of that with you. If you need toilets, this door on your right, it leads to our corridor. The ladies is the last door on the left. Our men's is in the back hall where kids' church is at. You make another left in the back hall, you'll find it. It looks like a storage closet, and it is. Go a little further, you'll find the men's toilets. I'm sorry, I wasn't the architect who designed this place. I would have put it in a much more convenient place. If you don't want to come up on stage, totally fine. You can go back out the main entrance, come around, and there's a side entrance you can sneak in for that. This week, like I said, we've had loads of guests with us, and it's been such a privilege to have them. And we've been, as a church as well, going out with them on the high street, sharing the good news of Jesus with people, having some amazing conversations about Christ on the high street, and doing lots of ministry, and lots of you from our church came out. And throughout the week, I've been really thinking about 1 Corinthians 3, where Paul writes to the church in Corinth, and he says this: "What then is Apollos? What is Paul? Servants through whom you believed, as the Lord assigned to each. I planted, Apollos watered, but God gave the growth. So neither he who plants nor he who waters is anything, but only God who gives the growth. He who plants and he who waters are one, and each will receive his wage according to his labor. For we are God's fellow workers. You are God's field, God's building. According to the grace of God given to me, like a skilled master builder, I laid a foundation and someone else is building upon it. Let each one take care on how he builds it. For no one can lay a foundation other than that which is laid, which is Jesus Christ." Obviously, if you've been in church a long time, you know the significance of Jesus. He is everything. He is the cornerstone of the faith. And it's because of him that we gather every Sunday to worship and sing. It's because of Jesus that we open up the Bible each and every Sunday to be have instruction for how to live the life that God wants. It's because of Jesus that we're willing to go around the world to other neighborhoods to share the good news of him. And today, as we go through the service, we're going to talk a little bit more about that importance of going around the world and getting the gospel to every corner so that everyone has an opportunity to hear of Jesus and from Jesus. But I thought it was very fitting to think of this as we have a lot of guests here today who came here to share Jesus, to join us. We had a lot of our teens and young adults going out on the high street this week sharing Jesus. Why? Because he is worth building everything on. There's nothing else that you can build your life on other than Jesus. And that's a wonderful thing. And that's something worth gathering and worshiping about. And so thank you so much for being with us, whether this is your 100th time, first time, second time, or anywhere in between. I'm glad you're here today. And I hope it's a blessing and encouragement to you as we get a chance to worship Jesus this morning. As we continue to do that, I would love to go to the Lord in prayer. And so if you wouldn't mind joining me as we give this time over to him. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so incredibly much for Jesus and the resurrection, which we celebrated last Sunday at Easter. Lord, we are honored that we get an opportunity to so freely gather together this morning to open up your word and allow your truth to reign in this place. Lord, I'm thankful for each and every person here today. May they be encouraged. May they be able to walk out these doors with what they need spiritually to live out this week for you. God, we are thankful for our guests from North Carolina and America that have come over to help join us in partnering together to share the good news of Jesus with the people here in Bexley. And Lord, we pray that this morning it would be a time of celebrating what God is doing, not just in our church, but in churches all around the world. Lord, may you remove the distractions. May you help us not to dwell on all of the things we have to do this afternoon and the busyness of work this week, but may we, for the next hour, just focus solely on you. Allow us to the Spirit to reign in this place and to speak to us and guide us and direct us so that we can leave here equipped to do what you have planned for us to do this week. And we ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. If you wouldn't mind standing again and joining us as we continue to sing this morning.
This song is one of our students at our church's probably favorite songs. And it talks about the freedom that we have when we have trusted Christ to forgive us of the wrong things we've done. And so I just invite you to think about these words and to fully worship God with a whole heart this morning.
Without hope and no place to begin, your love made a way to let mercy come in. When death was arrested and my life began, well, ash was redeemed, only beauty remains. My orphan heart
free.
song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. Oh, we're free, free forever, we're free. Come join the song of all the redeemed. Yes, we're free, free forever, amen. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life began. When death was arrested and my life sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. The only one who could ever say, worthy of every breath we could ever breathe, we live for you. sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever be. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you.
I heard someone this week talking about how they wanted factual evidence for God's existence. And this song talks about how creation cries the praise of God because it's just so evident that there was a master creator. And so as you sing this song, I just want you to think about how God has revealed himself to you.
If it puts me in the fire, I'll
Dear God, I thank you so much for Welling Church. I thank you for all the people you brought here today to worship you and to grow closer to you. Father, I pray that if there's anyone here that does not know you, that today that they would hear the gospel and that they would learn about how much you love them and how you sent your only son to die so they could be forgiven of the wrong things that they've done. Lord, we love you so much and thank you for just all that you've done and who you are, God. You're so good. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. You may be seated. I just want to say thank you so much for joining us this morning, and as we sang out this morning, we want to have Christ magnified in our life. This is what we want to do, and this is what our church is about. We want to have in every aspect of our life for Christ to be magnified. And so I want to say thank you so much for joining us in our worship service this morning. We have a lot to get through. We have so many things that we want to share with you, and so I'm going to start today. The first thing that you might be wondering is, why am I here? You're like, why is this American here? Oh, stop it. Oh, stop it. Thank you so much for that. I appreciate that. I was expecting more of a bigger applause, but I'm a little embarrassed now. So the thing I want to read to you is from 2 John verse 12. It says, though I have much to write to you, I would rather not use paper and ink. Instead, I hope to come to you and talk face to face so that our joy may be complete. And, you know, there's so many things that I would love to write to you, but I would rather just visit you in person so I can have my joy be complete. And it's been since September since I've been able to come and be here and worship with you on a Sunday morning. And it's so amazing to be able to just to be able to sing, just to be able to worship with you face to face. And so I'm just overflowing with joy. So I made some promises that I wouldn't get emotional today. I'm going to do my best. I'm going to fail miserably. So please just bear with me and don't give me those evil stares that you're giving me right now because I'm already feeling it right now. So my heart's like, and so that Red Bull's not helping. So what I'm going to do is next week, next Sunday, I'm giving you a little teaser. Next Sunday, I'm going to share a lot about what's been going on the past couple of months in our family's ministry, and I'm going to share a lot of what we're going to be doing for the next couple of months, and God willing, what we're going to be doing for the next couple of years. And so God's been doing a lot of stuff and really kind of focusing our family's life and our family's ministry when it comes to church planning and when it comes to church ministry abroad. And so God has been very gracious, and we're very thankful for God's been kind of guiding us and using us. And one of the things that we've been praying about is, obviously, we don't want God to take Welling Church out of the equation for us. And so we want to still do ministry here as much as we can, even though we know God is kind of taking us other places to do missions and to do church planting, other places in England and also other places around the world. So I'm going to share more of that next Sunday because when I came back, for some reason, I brought 26 other Americans with me. I know, yes. I'm so thankful for this wonderful church. I've known this church since 2009. I visited this lovely church, and they have been supporting our missionary, our family since then. As Justin shared with you this morning, we would not be here ministering with you and ministering here in England without their support financially, but also spiritually through prayers and just encouragement. We're so thankful. They've been so faithful. Every single month, they have been behind us every step of the way, through the ups and through the downs. And I've been talking with their trip leader for many, many years. They've been wanting to take a trip over here to work with our church for a long time. But of course, with all the lockdowns and with COVID, that prevented them to be able to do that. And so they were able to finally come this year. And so we're so thankful they're able to come to be able to do an evangelistic missions trip, and they have just done a fantastic job going out on the high street. And many of them, this is their first time out of the country,
first time going to England, the first time engaging in one-on-one conversations, telling someone about the gospel, the first time really talking to someone that's a Muslim, that's a Sikh, someone that's a Hindu. They've never had that opportunity before to sit down with someone and to engage with someone and to share the love of Jesus Christ with them. And they've just done a wonderful job, and we are the better for it. We are blessed by that. But more important, Christ has been magnified because of that. And so we are just so thankful for what they've done and the blessing that they've been to our church because of that. And so after the service, you know, please get around and chat with them, get to know them, talk to them, just, you know, ask them all the different things, because, you know, just like in England, you know, you have that main sort of city like London, but then you get out and there's all these little villages and towns all across England. Where they're from, you know, there's a really big city, but then you drive an hour out, they're in a smaller town, in a more rural area, and they can kind of tell you kind of their town. It's a place called Dunn. D-U-N-N. Just one syllable. Done. And they're done with it. And so it's just like done. So that's all I got for there. So I've invited their trip leader, Chuck, to come forward. I don't know where he's at. There you are, Chuck. Let me go ahead and get the microphone for you. If you could come up and let's see. Do I need to turn it on? Click it? Is it on? Let's see. Okay, there you go. Just to share a little word of encouragement, thanks, and what this trip means to him and everything like that.
We're so glad to be with you all for this week, and I have been the youth pastor at Central Baptist Church in Dunn for about 8 years, and my first year there in 2016, we had a Sunday where they emphasized missions and all the missionaries our church supports, and so we got to hear different reports, and that Sunday morning, there was a video submitted from Pastor Tarl, and it was a video of him in London sharing everything and all God was doing, and I remember back then, almost 10 years ago, God putting in my heart, I would love one day to take a team of our students and their parents and some of our adults to London. And so years later, God worked out the details. So we've been talking about this for over a year. And our team has been raising money and preparing for this trip for over a year. We couldn't wait to get here, and we survived the jet lag. And Pastor Tarl and Pastor Justin, they told us when we first got here, you have to stay awake all day. And so they took us to Big Ben, and they showed us all the sights. And thankfully, I was talking to Tarl and Justin on the train, and I was falling asleep while talking to them. But they kept me awake. They did it. We are just overwhelmed at what God is doing here at this church, and getting to hear Pastor Justin's heart. I never met him or talked to him before this, and Pastor Tarl, but also all your leaders, and we have enjoyed getting to know your students who have been with us. Mary and Sienna want to come over to North Carolina, so they might try to sneak with us. We just had a great time, and over the years, and I'd heard so much. This is my first time in the United Kingdom, and I heard so much of the history of this place, and really, the faith of America's roots come from the United Kingdom. But a lot of what I had heard was how this is just dead and dry and no spiritual life. And while we may have a lot more people in America that claim to be Christians, what we've seen this week is this is a searching country, a country that is hungry for the only thing that satisfies, and that is a relationship with Jesus. And so we've been able to see that as we've gone out on the high streets in Bexley Heath and Welling and had conversations. And we've been able to see through the ministry of Pastor Justin and Pastor Tarl and the leaders of the lives that have been changed by the gospel right here in this church. And I love hearing the stories of how people have grown in their faith. And this morning, just as we're singing songs together, I was thinking of Revelation 7, verse 9, where it says, "After this I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, 'Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb.'" And I think about, we may have quite a big pond separating our two churches, many miles. But this is, for me, a reflection of what we all who follow Jesus get to look forward to one day. That we will all one day be standing around the throne of God, worshiping Him together. So we've gotten a little glimpse of heaven this morning, worshiping with you and with your church this week. And so we thank you so much for your hospitality. And then this is one of our students on the trip. Savannah, how old are you? She's almost 17 years old, and she's going to be sharing a little bit about her week, too.
Wow, there's a lot of you. Hey, guys. So I'm from North Carolina, from Central Baptist Church, and thank you guys so much for letting us come to y'all's country and get to share the gospel with people. It's been amazing. When I came over, I was a little bit scared. It was kind of out of my comfort zone, especially when he was saying, we're going to go out on the high street, and we're going to approach people, and we're going to ask them, if they know who Jesus is. And I was like, that's scary. That's really scary. And I'm extroverted, so it was like, oh. But we started doing it, and I began realizing God has been teaching me that my joy is exclusively found in Him. And so there are things in this world that might make me happy, like ice cream's really good, or, you know, different things like that. But my joy is exclusively found in Christ. So no matter how many people were, you know, if I had a good conversation, but they were very set in their ways and they didn't want to accept Christ, you know, no matter how many people said no, that they didn't want to talk with me, it couldn't change the fact that my joy was found in God. And so even when people were saying, no, I don't want to talk to you, I could still approach another person with a smile on my face because of the God I was representing. And so it's just meant the world to me coming here and realizing that even when you're talking with, you know, someone of a different faith who, you know, thinks that you're believing the wrong thing, it doesn't matter because this is your God, your faith, and, you know, you should not be ashamed of the gospel of Jesus Christ. So thank you guys so much for letting us come.
All right. Thank you so much for that. Thank you so much, team, for being a part of our services. Thank you so much for being a part of our ministry. One of the things that we kind of timed and one of the things that we wanted to share with you is we wanted to share some special announcements. I know the past couple months have been kind of rough for our church in some ways, not in all ways, you know. The thing about ministry is that it carries on. You know, we have some ups and we have some downs, and ministry continues on without you. And one of the things that I love about this church is that it is carrying on boldly. It's carrying on with the gospel. And I'm so thankful that you guys are about Christ and you are about sharing the gospel even after with all these ups and downs. And so, you know, with our family moving on but not forgotten, and then also with the ups and downs with Jason and Kaylin with their visa issues, which is just, you know, really just a blow to all of us because we care for them, we love them, with just being a part of the ministry and really the heart and soul of what we do at the church. That's tough. And it's unexpected. Last Sunday, Justin got to share a special announcement of how we're still going to carry on with camp. You know, we're going to have camp this summer for the teens. And we saw what a wonderful blessing last summer was, where we had 10 young people accept Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior. And that was just an incredible work of God, where we spent so much time developing the teen ministry and so much time teaching and investing. And then to be able to see that wonderful harvest that happened last summer, and then to continue on with that this summer. That's an amazing thing to do. And then we also have a special announcement next Sunday that we're going to share with you. So you got to come back next Sunday for that. And that one is exciting as well. And that's unrelated with what I'm going to be sharing with our family's ministry and everything like that. So, I mean, this is going to be exciting. This is going to be good stuff, okay? But the special announcement that I want to share with you today is something that I've been looking forward to for a few months, and it's been a work in progress that we've been praying for, that Justin's been praying for, that our family's been praying for. And it's something that Justin and I, you know, the whole reason why we're here is because of churches like Central Baptist in North Carolina, because they believed in us. You know, they cared for us. And not just that they believed in us, but they believed in getting the gospel out around the world. You know, they said, you know what, we want to get the gospel out in our community, but we also want to get the gospel out around the world. Because just as Pastor Chuck said, hey, when we get to heaven, we're going to see every tribe and every nation and every tongue gather around and worship the King, worship Christ, and say, worthy is the Lamb. And what a wonderful day that is going to be. And it's going to be much like what we see right now before us here in Welling. It's going to be an exciting time. And just as Justin and I, and just as Welling is the beneficiaries of that, well, we've been, you know, since the very beginning, since 2018, since we got the chance to be a part of this church, we wanted to do that ourselves. And we started looking for ministry partnerships that we could start supporting here in our community, that we could say, hey, how can we partner, not just working, getting the gospel out here, but how can we help get the gospel out in other places in our community, but always with the thought of how can we support a missionary abroad? And that's always what we wanted to do. How could Welling Church support a missionary in a foreign field? And thankfully, we found just the right person. And so let's go ahead and roll the video.
Hello. Since I left London, I really miss you guys so much. I miss seeing all your beautiful faces, lovely smiles, and I miss being able to serve you and serve alongside you as well. But I just want to give you some updates about my life here in the Philippines. Obviously, it was very difficult for me to accept that I could no longer work for Welling Church, and I took my time to grieve over it, prayed for God's comfort and strength. And obviously God is good and always faithful. And after a few months, I was back to being busy again. I took a temporary job in HR consultancy while serving at this local church that I'm attending in Cebu. It's called Grace Baptist Church in Cebu, where I'm back to playing the guitar again and singing. And I'm gonna also deliver a lecture on biblical counseling this next month. All really exciting things. But here's a more exciting thing, you know. This coming May, I'll be moving to the capital city of the Philippines in Manila. I'm in the process of applying as an official missionary under a missions board called Global Missionary Clearing House. All thanks to Tarl for really working hard and helping me connect with the right people. So this coming May, I'll be working with missionaries from America. Sounds familiar. And I will be serving at their main church called Global Surge Worship Center. I'll be trained with how they do evangelism, you know, with their materials there, how they do discipleship and evangelism before I move on to there are various church plants, you know. Wow, various church plants, just like Welling Church. It's a church plant. These various church plants are probably not as cool as Welling Church, but it's okay. I'll manage. Seriously. It's an amazing opportunity. I'll be able to establish women's ministries there and be able to preach and teach. And I'm really excited about all those missions opportunity. And I want to thank you, Welling Church, for being my sending church. You know, it's cool that you have your own missionary here in this side of the world. Thank you for that. And Thank you for I really request for your prayers, pray for a smooth transition for me into this new ministry context here in the Philippines, because obviously in Europe it's different. People in the UK, when you go to the high street evangelism, they openly and publicly say that they don't believe in God, that they are not religious at all, that they can believe whatever they want. But obviously in the Philippines, it's very different. People here take pride in their religious roots, in their Roman Catholic background, and they're very, you know, they're extremely religious, and they claim that they believe in God and Jesus, but they're not really genuine born-again believers. So it's a very different approach to evangelism here. So please pray for a smoother transition for me, that I can learn new things as much as I can and as fast as I can. I pray for God's provision, because right now I will be, at this time I will be, you know, raising my own financial support. Pray for churches to partner with me in this amazing missions opportunity. And so I will send you more updates sometime soon. But for now, thank you. God bless and goodbye.
All right, everyone get out your phones. Everyone get out your phones if you're on the church WhatsApp. So if you're not on the church WhatsApp, then I'm sorry. You miss out on this. Jason's on right now, so you need to congratulate her. You need to talk to her right now on the church WhatsApp. Let her know that you just watched the video, and congratulate her. Let her know that you're praying for her, only if you are going to pray for her, okay? So here's the deal, and I'm going to give you the quick skinny, and then I'm going to dismiss the teens. We are going to be her sending church, which means we're going to be the church responsible for her sending out, representing her. We're going to be the church behind her. We're going to be the church giving the main bulk of her support. We're going to be supporting her at £200 a month, okay, which is over half the support that she needs, all right? We serve a sovereign God. Obviously, this is not what we want, but God is in control. God knew what was going to happen. And she is going under a missions board where she not only is going to serve at the beginning stages within a different island in the Philippines, but then she's going to start working on multiple different church plants in other countries in Southeast Asia. And because of her skill set, because of her education, and because she's worked in European churches, she's on a whole nother level than other people where she's at, okay? And so it puts her in a higher degree than other people. And so God obviously knows what he's doing better than us. And so we're so thankful that we get to be behind her, and we're so thankful that we get to be her sending church to support her in prayer and to support her in finances, which means that you need to continue to give, and you need to continue to pray for what she's doing. Because even though, you know, we're sad that she had to leave here, we still get to be a part of Jason's life. We still get to be a part of her ministry. And what's even better is that we get to still continue doing ministry here, but we're affecting ministry over in the Philippines. And we're affecting ministry on all the other islands in Southeast Asia because of what Jason is doing. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that incredible? So what I'd like to do before we dismiss the teens is I'd just like to pray for Jason right now and ask for God's hand upon her. So if you could bow with me, let's pray for Jason. Dear Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this morning. Thank you so much for Jason. Thank you for just letting us hear that wonderful update for her. I pray that you just keep your hand upon her, continue guiding her, continue giving her counsel and wisdom and comfort and strength as you allow her to join this missions board. Help it just to be a wonderful fit. Please give her the strength and boldness to be able to know what to do, to be able to navigate through these beginning stages. Help her to go to the right place at the right time, the right country. We pray that we as a church can stand behind her. We as a church can support her faithfully. We as a church can remember to prayerfully just be behind her every step of the way. Lord, I pray that we can be used of you to continue to support her her ministry all the way around the world. We love you and we praise you and we thank you. And we ask these things in your son's name. Amen. All right, let's go ahead and dismiss the teens. Go ahead and go back there. Dolan, if you want to come on up. Everyone else turn to 2 Corinthians 5. Where did Dolan go? Come on up. And then everyone else, if you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn to 2 Corinthians. Now, I know we've been going long because we had all these special announcements. I promise you, I won't preach longer than 50 minutes. Okay? So if your roast is in the oven, it's already burned. I apologize. All right?
Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. But what we are is known to God, and I hope it is known also to your conscience. We are not commending ourselves to you again, but giving you cause to boast about us, so that you may be able to answer those who boast about outward appearance and not about what is in the heart. For if we are beside ourselves, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For the love of Christ controls us, but we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him, who for their sake died and was raised. For now on therefore we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh. We regard him thus no longer. Therefore, if anyone in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. All this is from God, who through Christ reconciled us to himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, and counting their trespasses against them, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ, God making his appeal through us. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. For our sake, he made him to be sin, who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteous of God.
In the early 1800s, there was a famous poet named Elizabeth Barrett. She was one of 12 children. And, you know, she injured herself when she was around 15 years old, saddling a horse. She injured her spine, and then she burst a blood vessel later on in her chest. And it kind of made her a little bit bedridden to her room. And as fate would have it, she developed during all of this time really a love for reading, a love for writing, a love for poetry. And during the 1800s, she really became the greatest poet of her day. She wrote just wonderful poems that people still study even now. You know, one of these ones, you know, "How do I love thee? Let me count the ways." Or big long ones like, you know, "Sonnets from the Portuguese," and just countless other poems, world famous. And she was even famous in her own time. People from all over the world would make trips just to meet her. But she had a very domineering father, which forbid any of her own children, for whatever reason, to marry. You know, his wife passed away, and all he had was his kids, and he just wanted to keep all his kids to himself and forbid any of his own kids to marry. And And because she was so famous, you know, she attracted a lot of attention. And there was a gentleman named Robert Browning that wanted to meet this lady because, you know, her verse was just so incredible. And it's not like he just had pictures just plastered everywhere. He's just like just so enamored with what she wrote. It's like, how could you just write such incredible language? I had to meet this person. And so he set up all sorts of opportunities to try to meet this lady. And they started a correspondence back and forth before they met. And one of the things that she referred to herself by, this is what she called herself. She says she's nothing but a root fit for the ground and the dark. You know, she didn't think much of herself. But he wasn't discouraged. He just tried his best to continue meeting. And they finally met. And not only did they meet, but they continued to meet. And this is how interesting it is, and this is how enamored Robert was with meeting her. He documented how many times that they met before they eventually eloped. They met 91 times. Could you imagine? Like, this is how, he's like, I'm marking it down how many times I met with this person, you know, just because I got to write down every single instance that I've been with this person that I'm just so enamored with. But of course, her father was very much against them getting married. And so they secretly ran off, and they married in the north of London, and they went off to Italy, and that's where they lived for pretty much the rest of their life. But because she loved her father, you know, she was the favorite, she would write to him pretty much every week, write a letter to him. And you know, when you're a wizard at writing, you know, you could imagine what these letters were like, you know, and you can go and read these online if you want, you know, and just the poetry and the language and, you know, what she would want to say to her father, and every week she's sending off this letter back to England, trying to rekindle and restore this relationship, and she never heard back from her father. And of course, she didn't know this, but about a year before her father eventually died, and this is after 10 years of writing letters, she received a box in the post from her father. And of course, she's excited, because she's like, oh, wow, finally. You know, I'm getting something from my dad. I wonder what it's going to be. And so she opens it up, and of course, you know, that joy turns to despair, because what is it? It's all her unopened letters. Just sad, just shocking, you know? He didn't even open them. He didn't even look at them. You know, of course, it's a very Victorian era thing to do, to not even look at the letter that was sent to you. And he just collected them all, put them in a box, and ship them back to her. And a year later, he's dead. And I just think about how awful that is, and I think about how awful that would have felt for her for the rest of her life. And really how sad for him, maybe how brokenhearted. I don't know how he felt. But it really comes to this idea of an alienation. You know, there's an alienation. You know, we just read in 2 Corinthians, you know, this idea of reconciling, you know, to reconcile, you know, this separation, you know, and we have to be reconciled, you know. And this wonderful poet, because of her love for her husband, whom she stayed with for the rest of her life, and they had a wonderful relationship. You know, it's almost the stuff, in some ways, of fairy tales. But she could never bring back the relationship with her own father, just because he did not want her to marry. And it was separated. And I think, you know, in some ways, and in many ways, this is the problem with many of us. You know, we are alienated in some ways, in many ways, from something. You know, we're facing an alienation, and we need reconciliation. You know, but the biggest thing that we're in needing of reconciling is with God. You know, because of that sin, because of that separation due to sin, it causes that separation. You know, we talk a lot about Christ, and we talk a lot about what Jesus did on the cross. And the reason being is because he's the one that brings that reconciliation back together. He's the one that brings us back to God. You know, God wants us to be back with him in relationship. And we are alienated from him, and there's nothing we can do on our own to come back to God. That's why we have to have Christ. And it's almost as if God continues over and over and over again, every single day, sending a love letter, sending his grace, sending his mercy, sending something to you to try to bring you back to him. And you say, no, I don't want that. And you imagine what he's doing to the entire world. He's trying to send his love to the entire world. And they say, no, I don't want that. Or I'm not interested in that. And you imagine how heartbreaking that is. How awful that is. Of that separation. That we don't want to have anything to do. But the wonderful thing is this. Is that through Christ's reconciliation, he has overcome our alienation. Because of what he's done on the cross, he's overcome it all. And when we look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul discusses this in depth. You know, I love these letters that Paul writes to the church at Corinth. You know, he sends some very personal, very emotional letters to this church. We know just from these two letters that he actually sent four letters to this church in Corinth. And of course, two of them were lost, but we have two before us. And this second one is one of the most emotional ones out of all of them, out of all of his letters. And you can see him actually pleading with the believers there, speaking to them, almost with tears as he's writing to them. And he's talking about why he does the things that he does. Why does Paul do the things that he does? Why does he endure the things that he does? Why does he preach in the manner that he does? And so what I want to do for today and for next week, because it's kind of a two-part series, I want to examine two fundamental things and kind of smush them together. But it comes from 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14, all the way to 21. We're going to look at the first thing today, and we're going to look at the second thing next week. But the fundamental thing that we're going to look at is that Christ's change in us creates his purpose for us. Christ's change in us creates his purpose for us. And so we're going to look at that, on what that means for us today as we kind of go verse by verse. And the big thing that we're going to look at today is, what does it mean to be changed in Christ? So if you're taking notes, or if you'd like to take notes, we're going to kind of break this down. But this is the overall umbrella of what we're going to look at both this Sunday and next Sunday. So the first thing that we see, Christians, believers are radically, if you are a believer in Christ, you're radically, fundamentally, and eternally changed through faith in him by having a new love. So let's look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14. It says, "For the love of Christ controls us, because we have concluded this, that one has died for all, therefore all have died." The love of Christ controls us. We have a new love. Remember, what's the most famous verse in all of the Bible? Does anyone remember that? Does anyone know? Most famous verse in all the Bible? John 3:16. Can anyone quote it? Man, you guys are on it. I love it. Man, all right, let's all go to the high street. We're all ready. That's amazing. I love this. Most famous verse in the Bible. You know, I've only met a handful of people, most of them in England, that don't know that that's the most famous verse. They don't know that verse, you know, that God loves the world. And how did he demonstrate his love for the world? By sending a son. You know, how do we know that God loves us? Well, we already know that God loves us because he already demonstrated it for us 2,000 years ago. This is why we continue talking about what Jesus did on the cross. He already showed his love for us by sending his son on the cross. See, we have a new love that's rooted in the love of Christ that he has for us. Christ died for us so that we might live, that we might live eternally, that we might live in him, with him, through him, for him. He sacrificed himself for us because he loves us. In 1 John chapter 4, verse 9 and 10, it says, "In this, the love of God was made manifest among us, that God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. In this is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins." He initiated it. He started it. He began it. When we were living in sin, when we were living on our own, without God, without Jesus, without knowledge of him, we didn't know anything about that. But because God initiated all these things, this is how we knew about this new love, because of what Christ did on the cross for us. And now, because of his love, and if we put our faith and trust in him, being radically changed through faith on his son, well, it changes everything. And this new love, rooted in the love that Christ has for us, now we have this love for him. It becomes a two-way street. And what is Paul saying in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14? This love of Christ, now it controls us. It controls us. The question is, do you live that way today? Does the love of Christ control you? You know, you can profess these things logically. You can claim these things theologically. But do you perform these things volitionally? Do you do these things? Do you act these things? Do you live these things? You know, the Apostle Paul was so overwhelmed by Jesus' love for him that to serve and to honor Christ became the controlling motive of his life. Why was Paul a missionary? Why was he planting churches? Why was he dealing with hardships? Why was he enduring pain, suffering, torture, beatings? Because the love of Christ was controlling him. It should control everything that we do, act, think, believe. There should be no selfishness on the part of the Christian who understands the love of Christ. You know, before coming to Christ, we didn't know what real love was. After coming to Christ, we know what real love looks like, and that's what motivates us. You know, believers have a new love for Christ because Christ first loved us. And now that love overrides. It overrides everything in our lives. You know, I remember what that first, like, like what that looked like, you know, in my life when I had my first kid. You know, we're in the hospital, and you know, my wife's there. She had to be there, I let her be there. And so it's my first son. He's getting ready to graduate school and go to uni. He's 18 years old. You know, we're getting ready to celebrate that in 1 month's time. It's crazy to think about how old I am. It's really sad. But like 18 years ago, he was just like coming into the world, you know? How weird that is. And so like, I remember all of it as clearly as I'm looking at you now. You know, we're driving to the hospital, you know, and we're going, and we're checking in, doing all the stuff, and all the breathing, and all the getting in, and, you know, I'm trying to be the supportive husband, you know, and so it's like you're supposed to, like, touch the person. As soon as I touch the person, my wife said, "Don't touch me," and I'm like, "Oh, okay, all right, now what do I do?" So I just stood in the corner, just like this, you know. That's all I did. That was my whole big part, you know. Justin passed out. That's what he did. So, you know, at least I was conscious, all right? So like, Beckham arrives, okay? He's there, all right, crying, doing his thing. And as, you know, he's there, they let you hold him, you know, good. And then they let the mom hold him, good, okay? Well done, right? Okay, everything checks out. And then they hand him off to the nurse so they can start doing all the measurements and all the weighing and all the stuff. Okay, but then one of the nurses begins to start, like, manhandling him, you know, and, like, start, you know, because it's like, hey, we've done this a million times before, this is just another kid, right, doesn't matter, so they're just like, whatever, you know, bending him all sorts of, and, oh, my goodness, I was like, what, I was like getting ready, this is nice. I almost punched that lady in the face. Like, I don't know if I should confess this in church, but like, I was almost ready, and I was like, wait a minute, am I supposed to do that? Is that allowed? I don't think I should do this. And I was like, wait a minute, she knows what she's doing. She's a nurse. She's done this a million times before. She knows you're not, you know, what a baby can do, you know? And I was like, why am I feeling like this? Why did I feel like all of this rage come up before me in an instant when this person's doing all this sort of stuff? And it's like, oh, you know, there's this little tiny person that, like, all of a sudden, instantly, I love, you know? I'd never met this person before, you know? But in that moment of meeting that person that I did not meet 1 minute before, I knew I would do anything for that person, which was like such a crazy feeling to think about, you know? Here's what I'm getting at, is that a new love, it changes everything. It changes everything. And, you know, we can talk about a new love for a child, a new love for a girlfriend, boyfriend, new love for a spouse, you know, a friend, all that sort of stuff. That's all wonderful, and that's nice. That's a blessing, okay? But what's the greatest new love? That's going to be the one from Christ. That's going to be the thing. That's going to be the thing that overrides all things. And this is what Paul is getting at. The love of Christ controls us, controls everything. And when you have the love of Christ, when you are a believer, when you are a Christian, when you have said, I am turning away from sin, I am turning away from death, I am turning away from hell, I am turning away from that life, and I want to say yes to God, I want to say yes to Jesus, I want to say yes to heaven, I want to give my life to God, then all of a sudden that new love takes over, and that is the thing that controls you. Well, here's my question. What is the thing that captures your affections? What is the thing that motivates you? What is the thing that controls you? Why do you come to this church? Is it because a sense of duty, a sense of good works, or is it a sense of genuine love, of honor and worship for God? You know, if your decisions are about anything else other than the love that you have for Christ, maybe you do not have a genuine understanding of what it means to be a Christian. Or maybe you are a Christian that has hardened your heart as a result of sin. So that's the first thing. Second thing, I'll go through these fast. Calm down. Your roast is fine. It's safe. Okay? The second thing, let's see in verse 15, 2 Corinthians. And he died for all, that those who live might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. From now on, therefore, we regard no one according to the flesh, even though we once regarded Christ according to the flesh, we regard him thus no longer. So, here's what Paul's talking about. Christ died for all, that we might no longer live for themselves, but for him who for their sake died and was raised. So, we talked about new love. Now, what happens when you are a Christian? What happens when you are a believer? The reason why I'm talking this way is, what did we just have last Sunday? Man, that was weak sauce, all right? What has Justin been preaching to you guys? I'm getting worried. What happened last Sunday? Easter, thank you, okay? Leading up to Easter, what have you guys been talking about? Now I'm getting worried, Justin. What's been going on, okay? The words of the cross, you've been talking about Jesus and all those things that Jesus has been speaking, especially leading up to the cross, on the cross, all that sort of stuff, okay? From what I hear, it's been amazing, okay? Mostly it's been from Justin, okay? He's been talking a good game, all right? My hope is, we've been talking about the gospel. The hope is salvation, life change. Now we're talking about what's the result of that as a believer and as a Christian. New love, now new life. Okay? New life. This is what happens. A new life that is not rooted in yourself. This is what Paul is saying in verse 15. You have a new life, but guess what? It's not rooted in yourself. You no longer get to live for yourself. You no longer get to live for your want, your desires, your hope, your dreams. It's no longer about me. Who's it about? It's about Jesus. Absolutely. It's about Jesus. This is what Paul is getting at. This is what his whole ministry is based upon. It is about one thing, Jesus Christ. And this is what was the problem that Paul was dealing with, the leadership and some of the people at Corinth. The people there were judging other people, and particularly Paul, according to the flesh. What does that mean? They're judging Paul according to their value system, according to how they would see, how they would deem people, not according to how Christ would see people. And Paul is reminding them, we no longer see people according to the flesh. We see people according to Christ. Everything changes when that happens. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 19 and 20, it says, For through the law I died to the law so that I might live to God. I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave himself for me. There can be no selfish desires in the heart of the Christian who understands the new life they have in Christ. Here's the big takeaway that I want you to understand. Believers have a new life in Christ because ultimately Christ changes everything, including what we live for in this world. What are you living for? What's your life about? You know, I'm reminded, you know, Paul is just not talking about a big game. He's just not talking the talk in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. He actually walks the walk. You know, multiple times he shares his testimony. And the last time he shares his testimony in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 26, he's actually arrested for sharing the gospel. Could you imagine being arrested for sharing the gospel? And now he's fighting for his life. He could curry favor with the people, and he could be let go. He could probably manipulate the situation, deny things, and get off and get out. But instead, he uses that as an opportunity to preach the gospel again to the people in charge. The people holding him, a guy named Festus, they say, hey, you know, come on, I want to hear the story again. And so then he drags along another king, a guy named King Agrippa II, who's the great-grandson of Herod the Great. You remember Herod the Great? We read about him every Christmas, who tried to kill Jesus when he was, you know, just a baby. He brings his wife, and they're all three gathered around, and they come with great pomp, and they sit, and it's just Paul in chains. And you can almost kind of see the picture. They're in a great hall, and he's standing there, and they're just sitting there listening to his story. And he goes and he proceeds and tells of his conversion, of how he became a Christian. And one of the things he talks about is, I was going this way, I was living this way, I was about this, but when I met Christ, what did I do? I completely changed. I went the other way. My life was radically transformed. My life was no longer my own. And this is the comment from Festus. Paul, you are out of your mind. That's what he says. Your great learning is driving you out of your mind. And then Paul says, I'm not out of my mind, most excellent Festus, but I am speaking true and rational words. And then he turns from Festus and looks at the king, King Agrippa. And he says, for the king knows about these things, to him I speak boldly, for I am persuaded that none of these things have escaped his notice. For this has not been done in a corner. King Agrippa, do you believe the prophets? Because he was aware of all this stuff. He believed in the Old Testament. He knew about this stuff. And then one of the scariest, but one of the most convicting things I've ever heard Paul say to another person, this is what he says to him. He says, I know that you believe. I know that you believe. I know that you believe. And then this is how he responds. Agrippa says, in a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian? In a short time, would you persuade me to be a Christian? You know, we come across people all the time. We know they're almost there. We know that it makes sense. And all they have is, that's just crazy. That's just nonsense. But we know it's true and it's rational words. But it just seems silly. It just seems crazy. But why would you do that? Why would you act this way? Because you have a new life. Everything has changed. Why? Because your life is about Christ. It's not about all those other things. All right, for the sake of time, I'll throw out a whole chunk. I'm getting some stares. Listen, I'm leaving in a couple weeks, all right? So, come on, man. Back me up, all right? Come on. All right, last one, we'll be done. Verse 17, everyone turn there. Hey, does anyone like chocolate-covered pretzels? Who likes chocolate-covered pretzels? Anyone? Let's go ahead and pass them out. All right. So as an olive branch, okay, we're gonna take a snack break, okay. How many churches do you go to where they give you snack breaks during the sermon? Anna, chocolate-covered pretzel, okay? Chocolate-covered pretzel? No, I'm not saying take it. You just don't take the bowl. Come on, chocolate-covered pretzel. Okay. I love chocolate-covered pretzels. Justin hates chocolate, full stop, which I don't know if he's even a Christian. Yeah, he hates chocolate, which I don't even know. But I love chocolate-covered pretzels. So grab some, eat it. We're going to carry on. This is to give us some sustenance, get that sugar going, okay? This is our snack break, okay? So number three, and then we're going to be done, all right? We're almost done, all right? Paul, don't look at me, all right? Verse 17, therefore, this is the last verse, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, did everyone get what they wanted? You can get some seconds. Greg has more. Get seconds. Don't be shy. Be greedy, okay? We got loads. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. The new has come. So we looked at a new love, a new life. The last thing we're going to see is a new transformation, a new transformation. This is what we're getting at, okay? Christ's change in us. Christ's change in us creates his purpose for us. We're going to look at purpose next week. This is a transformation. Christians are brand new people on the inside. The Holy Spirit gives them new life. They are not the same anymore. We are not reformed. We are not rehabilitated. We are not re-educated. We are a born-again believer. We are a new creation living in vital union with Christ. We are transformed to a new creation in which the old is gone. Everything about you that is gone, everything that kept you dead in the trespasses of sin has been removed. Sin's power and control over you has been removed. Ephesians chapter 2, we don't have time to look at that right now. Verses 1 through 5, that wonderful passage that explains what you were like before, but all that is gone. You are dead in your trespasses and sins, in which you once walked. You're dead there, and yet now you're made alive. You've been radically transformed through the grace of God. You're not simply turning over a new leaf, but you're beginning a new life, radically transformed through the grace of God. Going from the old, a new creation in which all things are new. God has made you a new person through the grace of him. God has literally made you a new creation. You know, we think of the words of Jesus talking to Nicodemus. If you want to see the kingdom of God, if you want to see the kingdom of heaven, you must be born again. You know, when we think about what God has to do with us. You know, we think about the blood of Jesus Christ. We think about being justified by his blood. You know, it's really graphic language. You know, it's really kind of not PC in this day and age. You know, it's not something that we just want to come out and share with other people because it's just kind of like gross, you know? Especially if you talk about Old Testament sacrifices, and then we talk about the cross and how graphic and how awful, and it's just, ooh, too much. But this idea of Christ, who knew no sin, who became sin for our sake. We were sinful, but we gained his righteousness because of Christ. Christ became unrighteous so we could gain his righteousness. We are covered with his righteousness. We are covered with his blood. And one of the best sort of visual kind of ideas behind this, in a silly way, you know, is this idea of chocolate-covered pretzels. I hate pretzels, man. My wife loves pretzels. I hate them. I hate pretzels. Like as a snack, as a treat to eat at nighttime while you're watching Netflix, that's gross. It's like just putting sand that's salty in your mouth. That's nasty. And she has a bag of them, and she's like, no, thank you. And she's very kind. Want one? No. But you offer me some chocolate-covered pretzels. It's like, well, howdy do. You know, it's like, I'll take 10 plus a few more, you know, and then I'll go to town. So I don't know what it is. It's still a pretzel, but you cover it with chocolate, and somehow everything changes. I hate pretzels, but you cover it with chocolate. I don't know, man. Everything changes with it. It's delicious. And I just imagine, you know, when it comes to us entering heaven, you know, what God sees, you know, it's like, ugh, nasty pretzels, right? But it's like chocolate-covered pretzels. It's like, ooh, this is delightful. This is good, you know? Everything changes. You've been transformed. You're a delight. You're a delight to God. Not because of you, but because of his son, Jesus Christ, that's justified you because of his blood. Everything has changed. And you've been changed for a purpose. If you could bow your heads and close your eyes. We're going to have a time of reflection, a time of meditation, a time of thought. I'd really like you to have a time of prayer with God. This is your opportunity, maybe to pray for yourself, to pray for a friend, a family member, maybe to think on the things that you heard or maybe some of the verses of scripture that you read. I'm going to give you a few moments, maybe to make some changes, maybe to do some business with God. I'm going to close in prayer in just a moment, and then we'll continue with worship. Dear gracious Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this morning, this opportunity that you've allowed us to come here to this place, to be able to lift up our hearts, our minds, our worship to you. Lord, I'm so thankful for the opportunity to be able to read your word, to be able to examine it, to think on it. I'm so thankful for your Holy Spirit to be able to penetrate our hearts and minds. Lord, I pray that you would just do your work upon us, that you would just pierce our very hearts and our very minds, that you would just please convict us of our sins, that you would just break our hearts, that we would see you afresh. Lord, we're so thankful that for those that have put their faith and trust in you, that you have radically, eternally, and fundamentally changed us. Lord, we're so thankful that we have that new love and that new life and that we have become that new creation because of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, I just pray that through all of that, that we would live for you. But I also pray for those that maybe they've never done that before. They don't know you as their Savior. They don't know you as their sovereign Lord. Lord, I pray that you would just impress upon their hearts their need for you, that you would just so overrule in their life that they would see you and their need for you. I pray that you would just bless them and help them to know you now. I pray that you would just continue being with us for the rest of this service and continue blessing our fellowship. And we ask these things in your Son's name. Amen.
Let's stand and worship together.
Thank you. You can be seated. Well, I want to say thank you so much for being here. If God is speaking to you through you, I pray that this will be a blessing. If you would like to pray with someone or speak with someone after the service, feel free to grab myself. My name's Justin. I'm one of the pastors. You can grab Tarl, who spoke, or any of our leaders. We'll be glad to sit down, pray with you, and talk with you after service. A couple notices before we go rescue all the adults in the back with the children. First and foremost is giving. Thank you so much for your generosity in giving each and every week. The money you give this church, not only does it help make the ministries happen here, but now it's going to help ministries around the world as we begin to start supporting people like Jason, and hopefully we add many more in years to come of other ministries and blessings around there. If you're a church member, continue your worship through giving. Always online is best, but if you need to, you can do it in person. If you're a guest, please don't give anything at all. That is for those who attend here to do so. This week, we're continuing Easter break, and so with being no school, there's nothing happening midweek. If you do need anything, feel free to shoot me a message. Be happy to try to meet up or catch up or even do a phone call if you need something throughout the week on that. There is one thing happening, and that is tonight we are having a young adult service. It's back one night only. The lovely band is going to be playing again for us, and Chuck... Yeah. Chuck, the leader from the team, he's going to be preaching tonight. And so I would encourage you, any young adults, please come back. If you're 18, 35, it's going to be wonderful. Teens are welcome to come. And if you're in 20s, 30s, you will love being back tonight. And at the end, there's going to be pizza party for everyone. And so it's going to be worth coming out. So come back tonight, 7 p.m. I look forward to seeing you there. With that, please go get some tea, some coffee, fellowship with one another, and I will see you back here next week, 11 o'clock. God bless.
I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus.